planning to look into the word of the Lord on today, and we trust and pray that something can be said to help edify us and build us up, because we're living in a day and a time where we need to be built up as much as possible. So I see here a situation in which I can't change what is going on around me, but I can change me.
Right.
How many know that there's power in prayer?
Yes.
Cause someone else to bless me. But there's power in prayer to work on me, to change me, maybe to change the way I think, maybe to change the way that I do things, maybe change my approach, the way I see myself, maybe the way I see others. And so we want to strive to do all that we can to work on ourselves so that we can make it in and be ready to go back with the Lord. I'll call your attention to a passage of scripture in the book of John, the 15th chapter. I want to read this passage of scripture. I'm going to ask you when you get it to stand to your feet. We're going to read a few verses of scripture here and then talk a little bit on this passage of scripture. This is John chapter 15, in the first verse. John chapter 15, verse 1. And the Lord is speaking to us here, and he says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches.
Yeah.
He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit.
Yeah.
For without me, ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them, cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you.
Yes, sir.
Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. Amen. You may be seated. Thank the Lord for the reading of the scriptures coming to us from John 15. Amen. And we thank God for the power that is in the word of the Lord. Amen. That I may be able to see something that maybe I miss. I want to be challenged. I want to be stirred up. I want that assurance that I'm examining myself and that I'm doing everything that I can do. There are others who come to the house of the Lord for purposes of justification and verification. There are some that don't want to be told anything. There are some that come because they already know that they're right. And what they desire really is
Just tell me that I'm right, preacher. And verify that what I'm already doing is already good enough.
Yeah.
I don't really want to go into any more challenging things. Don't tell me something new. Don't tell me something different. I've already been baptized. I've already repented. I said, I've been filled with the Holy Ghost. I've done what I need to do. Just let me know what I need to know in about 15 minutes. Let me just go on about my way, because I already got this thing figured out. And then there are others who come to the house of the Lord, and really all they want to do is just have a good time. Interest in the Word of God is very low. They're here basically for a good time in a social event. They would like to find out who's here, what's going on, what choir is singing, who's on the organ today, and really don't have an interest in the Word of God.
How you doing, sir?
What are you doing here today? What is your purpose? Our purpose should be to work out our soul salvation. Our purpose should be to examine ourselves and to prove our own selves. Our purpose should be to do everything we can so that when we have lived the life that God has given us, we can stand on His Word and say, Lord, I have done everything that I knew to do to make my calling and election sure.
Yes.
I want to be ready to go back with Him. The Bible talks here. So nowadays, most people don't have gardens. Well, then that's all people did have was gardens. People grew. People lived off of the land. Very agrarian society. So He talked in terms so that people could get an understanding. Mm-hmm. And the Lord began to talk about this vine. He said, I am the true vine. And my Father is the husbandman. And He says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, He takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, He purges it, that it can bring forth more fruit. So He is using a vine as a way for us to understand the relationship that we have with Him and He has with us. I remember when I was a little boy, for the early part of my life, I don't remember much about it, but I lived in Mount Vernon, up in Mount Vernon, New York, probably up until I was about 5 years old. And my great uncle, Uncle Theodore, he lived right next door to us on the street where we lived. And I can remember him vaguely. This is El Rufus's father. And I can remember him vaguely, but there's one thing I can remember about Uncle Theodore. He loved to grow things. And he had a grapevine on the back of that, in the backyard. I remember going to the fence and I could smell, I don't know what kind of grapes they were, but I could smell that sweet smell of those grapes coming off of that vine. And I remember tasting them. And I don't know the details of what kind they were and all of that. But I can remember how they tasted, how it smelled, how I felt getting exposed to that fruit. Jesus loves fruit. God loves fruit. And He's explaining to us that there is a vine. He's explaining to us about a husbandman, and He's explaining to us about branches. And He says plainly that we are the branches. He is the vine, and we are the branches. So, if you have in your mind, if we just use for general purposes, the vine being the main part of the plant, that vine, or the main part if it was a tree, it would be the trunk of the tree. It would be the center of it. If it was some type of if you want to take a peach tree, there's a center part of the tree. Yes. And then there are the branches that come off.
Yes.
You see, the tree is defined by the fruit that grows on the branches. Yes. So you know what kind of tree you're dealing with, not necessarily by looking at the tree when it's out of season, unless you know what kind of tree they are, but you don't even have to be a professional in the field to know that it's an apple tree when you see apples. You don't have to be a professional to know that it's a peach tree when you see peaches. So the fruit that shows up on the tree is a reflection of what that tree is all about. So that tree, the trunk of that tree, is settled and nestled into the ground. And the purpose of that tree being nestled and settled into the ground is because there are roots that are required to tap into the ground and to withdraw nutrients. And then those nutrients are drawn up through the main part of the tree, the vine. And then the branches that are attached to the main part of the tree then will produce fruit based upon what the makeup of that trunk of that tree is all about. The branches cannot choose what kind of fruit they are going to produce. The branches don't have a say-so. They are required to produce whatever the vine of the branch commands it to produce. So the branches have to produce fruit in order for the glory to be brought to the tree. So the Lord is telling us, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. And every branch in me that doesn't bear fruit, he takes it away. There's something wrong with a branch that doesn't bear fruit. There is something fundamentally wrong with a branch that is on a tree. It looks like it's attached to the tree. It looks like it's a part of all the other branches. But this branch isn't producing fruit. So if the branch is not producing fruit, we have a fundamental problem. Somewhere there is a disconnection between that branch and the vine. The branch is there. It's physically attached, but it is not intrinsically a part of that vine. There's something wrong. There's something missing, but it's still hanging on the tree. The Bible says that when the husbandman comes by, he looks at the tree and he looks to see which branches are bearing fruit. And for the ones that are not bearing fruit, he separates them, takes them off because they're of no use. There's no value. There's no purpose. What is the purpose of a branch that is just sitting on a tree if it's not producing fruit? And then he says, but if he looks and he sees a branch bearing fruit, he will purge it. So he'll grab that fruit so that that branch can produce some more fruit. Now, he says something here in the third verse. It says, now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Now ye are clean through the word which I've spoken unto you. See, the word is important. The word can't be understated. It can be understated, but it can't be overstated, the value of the word of God. The word of God is our life.
Yes, it is.
The word of God is the reason why we're living. The word of God is the thing that keeps us going. Without the word of God, we don't have anything. The word of God is the thing that we can focus on day and night, night and day, in the middle of the night. The word of God can come to us and restore our strength. The word of God, there's nothing like the word of God. And so as we grow in Him, and as we become more and more a part of God, we understand the value of the word. Anybody who doesn't understand the value of the word is missing a great blessing. The value of the word, though, and he said the word does a lot of things, but he says now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. So the word of God is doing something to us. The word of God is cleansing us. The word of God is getting us in a place where we can maintain a good relationship with God. If we want to be a healthy branch, then, and we want to abide in God, then we have to hold on to the word so that the word can cleanse us. We need the word to cleanse us. Hallelujah. We are in a battle. We are in a fight. There are all kinds of things that go through our minds every single day. We don't always think good thoughts. The devil brings bad thoughts. We have to fight against the bad and restore and re-energize the positive. You don't just go through the day doing everything right. We have to fight to do right. We have to fight to stay on the battlefield. We have to fight. But God is able, through His word, to keep us strong, to keep us dedicated to Him, and to keep us built up in Him. Thank God for the word of God. Because God, through His word, forgives us of our sin, forgives us of our wrong, gives us what we need, helps us when we're weak, and gives us a mind to not give up. It's not time for us to give up. It's time for us to hold on. It's time for us to hold on. So the Bible tells us that we need the word. The word cleanses us. Fourth verse, he says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. He said the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abides in the vine. He says, no more can you except you abide in me. And then he says plainly, I am the vine. You are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same will bring forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. Hallelujah. We need to be branches, we don't need to be rogue branches. We need to be branches that are holding on to God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to be a branch that's holding on to God, that's producing Amen. Some fruit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Abide in me. Stay with me. Hallelujah. Stay with me.
Amen.
When you stay with God, you don't allow any little thing to move you.
Yeah.
The Bible said again, Apostle Paul, I believe, said again, I marvel at how easily you're moved from the gospel of Christ unto another gospel, which is not
another.
Hallelujah. I marvel that it doesn't take much for you to move. I marvel that a little trouble can come along and sway your thought. Cause you to stop coming to church. Cause you to stop praying. Cause you to stop believing. Hallelujah. A little thing can come along and cause you to see, we need to understand that the fruit doesn't stop because of circumstances. The fruit continues to be produced because the branch remains attached to the vine.
Yes.
There are all kinds of fruit.
Mm-hmm.
There's all kinds of fruit. But one thing is for sure, you don't have to work to produce fruit. You're just going to produce fruit.
That's right.
There's going to be somehow, some way, the Lord's going to put it in your heart to do this or that or the other. That's going to be between you and God. That's how you know you're connected. You know you're connected when you have a mind to do something.
Yes, sir.
If you don't ever have a mind to do anything, you need to check your connection speaking to you. Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
We don't come out here just to do nothing and wait on glory to come.
That's right.
We look in to do everything we can to make our calling and our election sure. The Lord has given us life, health, and strength, and we need to be doing something. I'm not your judge of what you should be doing. I'm just letting you know you should be talking to the master and doing something. If you can go all year long and not do nothing, and year come, we're getting ready, if it's the Lord's will, this is the last month of the year 2017.
Yes.
If you have gone all the way from January
Jesus,
to December
Jesus.
And you haven't done anything for the Lord, something is wrong.
Yes, sir. Yes.
You went 12 months of God giving you life, 12 months God making sure that you wake up in the morning, 12 months the Lord protecting you all day long, all night long, God making ways for you out of nowhere. You're driving up and down the road, you're not getting into accidents, bullets flying over your head, you see them, sometimes you don't see them, all kinds of stuff, all kinds of problems.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of things that have happened this year. People getting shot going to school, shot in church, just all kind of crazy stuff going on. And you mean to tell me that in 12 months we haven't been able to find anything that we could do for the Lord? Nothing. If you went 12 months, you got about 3 more weeks. You need to be finding something. I mean, you need to be begging God, Lord, please talk to me.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
Because I might not be connected to you. Hallelujah. You see, this thing is not about what you can get. This thing is about what you can give.
That's right. Hallelujah.
The problem, one of the problems that we have now is that the givers are gone.
Oh, merciful Savior.
Don't let the giving leave.
That's right.
Where are the givers?
Yeah.
Serving God is not about getting.
That's right.
It's not about what can I get out of this deal. Serving God is what can I give to God for all that he has done. David declared, what can I do?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
For all the benefits
yes,
that the Lord has bestowed.
Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
The givers. Hallelujah. Are you a giver or are you a getter?
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. There are people who don't understand what love really is all about. Love is really not about getting.
What's that?
Love is about giving.
Yeah.
You know, our whole Christian life is based upon the fact that God is a giver.
Yeah. 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 That's right.
All Jesus did while he was here was give.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Jesus wasn't getting stuff. He was giving stuff.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Yes.
And our whole Christian, the basis of our whole Christian life is that we are givers. Not receivers. We read across the scripture that said, let's read a little bit more. We go to 7th verse. He said, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will.
Yes.
And it shall be done. There it is.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we want.
Yeah.
Ask what you will, and it shall be done. Mm-hmm. That's what we want.
Yeah.
Oh, that's it right there.
Mm-hmm.
That's yes, sir. Whatever I want, all I got to do is ask. That's what the Bible says.
Yeah.
But you got to understand the fullness what he's talking about.
That's right.
Hallelujah. It's more than just a blessing plan. Just ask whatever you want.
That's right.
It's not about that.
Yes,
what it's about is about you abiding in him.
Yes,
being a part of him.
Yeah.
The problem is that when you are always asking for stuff and always looking for stuff, you are not in a relationship with him. Any marriage is not going to last if you're always getting and you're never giving.
Amen.
There's no relationship between friends that will last if you're always getting and you never give.
Yeah.
But you know what happens to help a healthy relationship between two people? If each one is doing everything they can to give.
Yes.
If you've got two people and this one is always trying to give to that one, and that one is always trying to give to the other one, that's going to be a good relationship.
Amen.
But if you have a relationship where one or both are trying to always get from the other, that's not going to work. I don't care if it's brother to brother, sister to sister, wife to husband, friend to friend. I don't care what it is. If you are always trying to get something and you are never giving anything, it's not going to work.
No,
it's not going to work. The Lord, all he did was give.
Yes, sir.
That's all he did was give.
Right.
He came here giving.
Yeah.
God gave his only begotten Son.
Yeah. Yes, he did.
He laid his life down.
Yes, he did.
He helped. He healed.
Yeah.
He delivered.
Yeah.
He made ways for people.
Yeah.
He wasn't always looking for no handout.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
I ran across a man who were walking down the street and asked me for some money. Now, I don't usually carry money. And I don't believe I had any money. After I told him I did not have any money. told me, y'all ain't got no love in that church. I don't care what you say. Anybody ever been told, y'all ain't got no love?
Yeah.
But everybody, y'all ain't got no love. You know what that term really means? That really means, you have to understand what people say. When people say that, what they're trying to do is they're trying to abuse you. Say, if you don't do what they want you to do, then you don't have love. Love is not defined by, am I doing what you want me to do? Well, that's not love. That's not love. If that was the case, Jesus didn't have love.
Right. Yeah.
He was walking along, he was headed one place, and they told him, look, Lazarus. Lazarus is sick. You know what Jesus did? He kept on going. He didn't turn around and go back and save Lazarus from death. He didn't do it. There are a lot of things that happen in the Bible that meant that the Lord may have been able to turn, well, would have turned him around if he desired, but he didn't. If we use as a definition that love is you do for me as I want you to do for me, then Jesus ain't love. Because you're going to find fault with Jesus. You're going to say, you're going to look at the scriptures, and you're going to find something, you're going to say, he ain't got no love. That's what's wrong with the world today. Because the world defines its love based upon what I want. If you don't do for me what I want you to do for me, then you don't have love. And that's not the way we define love. That's not love. That's not love. How is that love? Love is more than give me what I want. And so we're in such a give me society that churches are packed out as long as the preacher keeps telling them what they can get. But what preachers need to tell people is what they need to be giving and not getting. And I have news for you. If you give from your heart, the Lord will take care of your getting.
Yes, he will.
But you can't, but you have to do it right. Because you can't use it as a way to give.
Right.
You can't give waiting for your blessing to come.
Right.
You can't do that.
Right.
If you're going to give, you got to give from your heart.
Yeah.
Why are you doing this? I'm frying this chicken because I love the people of God.
Yeah.
Why are you doing this? I'm vacuuming the church because I love the people of God. Why are you? I'm cleaning outside. I'm changing the light bulbs. I'm checking on pastor. I'm whatever it may be. I'm not doing it because I want a blessing.
Amen. Yeah.
But I'm doing it because I want to be a blessing.
Amen.
I'm not doing it to get money. I'm not doing it to get position. I'm not doing it to get some kind of a name for myself. But I'm doing it because there's something on the inside of me.
Amen.
That is causing me to want to do something regardless of whether or not I get anything back. This is an indication that I'm connected to the vine. I'm connected to the master. I'm not in control of myself. Why are you getting up early in the morning and going to the house of the Lord to check on this and check on that? Because there's something on the inside of me that causes me to break my sleep and to get up and to go see about the house of the Lord, because I want to make sure that things are done right, because God puts something on the inside of me. If we can become a people that are connected to God and make sure that we're doing what he wants us to do, then you won't have to worry about what you need, because the Lord will provide all of your needs. He knows what you need before you ask him. What he wants to know going to give your time? Are you giving your effort? Are you giving your love? Are you giving, yes, your money? Yes. Are you giving, or yes, are you just getting?
Yeah.
I want to be a giver. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And when I'm a giver, I know that I'm connected to the Lord, and I know that He's working through me. Then the things that He brings about brings Him glory. See, it's not about me getting glory. Whenever the branches that are connected to the vine produce fruit that the husbandman picks up gives glory to the tree, not to the branch, but to the tree. Because the branch isn't important. Why is that the branch isn't important? It's only important if it's connected to the vine. The branch by itself is not important. So when that branch is laying on the ground, the only thing it's good for is to take it up and throw it in the fire.
That's right.
We can't, if that branch can't be disconnected and produce fruit.
That's right.
It cannot be all alone by itself producing fruit.
No.
It can only be used for one thing, to get burned up.
That's right.
That's all it has use for. So that's why he said he is. So we're followers of the Lord because we are connected to the vine, and the vine is now using us to bring about fruit for his glory.
Right.
Now, the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that your joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. I told you these things because I want your, he says, my joy. He says, my joy. I want my joy to remain in you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And he says, and that your joy might be full.
Yeah.
So there is his joy, and then there's my joy.
Mm.
Hallelujah. My joy, hallelujah, is going to start, is going to be full when his joy,
yeah,
remains in me.
Yeah.
So I've got to have his joy first.
Yeah.
And the only way I can get his joy first is I've got to be connected to the vine.
Yeah.
The only way, if I'm not connected, I can't get his joy.
That's right.
Hallelujah. You see, we don't even know what we need unless we're connected to the vine. That's the reason why he said, ask what you will and it shall be done unto you.
Amen.
But you don't know what to ask,
right,
when you're not connected.
Amen.
So if you're asking and you're not receiving, that means you may have to check your connection.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because we know that the Lord does things in his own time.
Yeah.
How many people have asked God for something?
Yeah.
And you ask God, and then you forget about it.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. And by, as time goes on, maybe it's weeks, maybe it's months, maybe it's years, but guess what happens? Here comes the blessing.
Yeah.
Why? Because the Lord didn't forget. He's holding on to his word.
Yeah.
He's not asking you to stay on my back about the blessing. He said, ask what you will.
Yeah.
I'll do it. You just got to abide in me.
Yeah.
I want you to live for me Monday through Sunday.
Yeah.
I want you to walk in me. I want to have preeminence in your life.
Yeah.
I don't know. When you get the joy of the Lord on the inside, then all of a sudden your problems don't seem so big.
Yeah.
And all you want to do is rejoice in the God of our salvation. Hallelujah. Then, but how many know that you can be happy, you can be joyful, and still have a bag of problems. Hallelujah. Now we laid them at the altar. I'm going to let the Lord have his way. So there is a way to get your answers to every problem. There is a way to have joy unspeakable and full of glory. There is a way to lay down your head at night, even though you have trouble on top of trouble. There is a way to smile through the midst of hurt, pain, and persecution. There is a way to go through looking to the Lord, and that is to make sure that we abide in the vine. If we abide in the vine, the Lord is talking to us, and he's steadily putting fruit, and we're producing fruit for his glory and for his honor. We're not going to miss our blessing, because the Lord will keep every prayer. He keeps every concern. He has not forgotten what you prayed about 3 years ago. He knows just what to do, when to do it. All he wants us to do is abide in him. Abide in him. Stay with me. Don't give up on me just because it gets rough. Stay there. Hold on. Believe. Believe. When you don't see it, believe. Hallelujah. Just believe. When you don't feel it, believe. When you can't lay your eyes on it, believe it. Looks like it's going the wrong way. Keep believing.
Hallelujah.
I know where there's victory. There's victory when everything is going the wrong way and you get in your secret closet. And you say, I know everything looks like it's going wrong, but I still believe God. Hallelujah. Job said, though he slay me,
yet
will I trust him. I'm not giving up on him just because the road is a little bit rough. I'm not giving up now just because it's got a little dark outside and it's raining on my head and maybe I'm a little cold, but I believe in the Lord is going to bring me through this. I know what to do. I'm going to abide in him. I'm going to stay there. The Lord will do everything that he said he would. But he's God. He's not our footstool. He's God. Hallelujah. He rules the heaven and the earth. He rules everything breathing, everything moving, everything alive and not alive. He's God of it all. He'll make mountains to skip. Hallelujah. He'll cause the ground that we stand on to shake. Buildings to fall. This is a God that's not a toy. Not a toy. Hallelujah. Don't misuse his word. Whatever I ask, he'll do it. Yeah, but you got that. There's conditions. There's conditions. Don't play with God. Whatever I asked. He said he would do it. Yes, he did. But he's not a toy. He's not for us to play with. Hallelujah. He's a God that deserves our reverence. He's a God that deserves our full attention. He's a God that deserves our full sacrifice. Everything that we can do. Do you not know that if you serve God, if you do nothing, but worship God every second, every minute of your life until you take your last breath, you could never do enough to thank him for what he's done. Hallelujah. If you give everything you have, if you lay it all on the line, if you don't do anything else but worship God in church and stay here, and never move, you can never do enough to pay him for what he's already done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's not a God to play with.
No, he's not.
He's a true and living God. He said, if you keep my commandments,
you
shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you. Hallelujah. I want his joy to remain in
you.
Something's wrong when the joy comes and goes. Something's wrong. Hallelujah. It's not his fault. But if I'm abiding in him, hallelujah. You know, the Lord allows things to happen to us. Not for us, not for him to know where we are. But for us to know where we are. And you know you have some connection with the Father. Hallelujah. You know you got to. We're all human beings. We all face hurt, pain. We all face bad days, good days. We all face ups and downs. Hallelujah. But let me tell you one thing. When you face a down, and you can not, I'm not talking about you waiting on a preacher.
Come on.
I'm not talking about you waiting on your favorite song. I'm not talking about you calling up somebody to say a prayer for you. I'm not talking about getting with your best friend and tell them all about your trouble. I'm not talking about leaning on somebody else. I'm talking about when everything is going down. You know you have a connection. When you should be upset, and you can talk to God, and in the middle, I'm not talking about when your problem is solved.
That's right.
I'm talking about you still got the problem. You still got the trouble. You still got the hurt. You still got the pain. But you know you're connected. When you can talk to the master.
Yes, sir.
And you can talk to him. And after you talk, something happens on the inside.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good.
Yes, sir.
And you come out of there saying, I don't know how.
Yes, sir.
I don't know when.
Yeah.
But everything is all. You've got something that money could never buy.
Hallelujah.
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 Lord, I thank you.
Yes, sir.
Lord, I thank you.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
When it gets real bad.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm not looking at you, wondering when you're going to bring me out. Hallelujah. I know who to look to.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm looking to Jesus.
Yes.
My head lifted up, I'm looking at Jesus.
Yes,
sometimes, oh yes, sometimes I get a little down.
That's right.
And my head will drop. But because I'm connected to the Lord, it won't stay there. Something comes along and says, hold on a second, son. You connected to the vine. Talk to me.
Yes, sir.
Talk to me.
Yes, sir.
Let my word. Let my word travel through that mind. Let my word get to your brain. Let my word get in there. And we're going to produce some fruit. Joy is fruit.
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah, joy is fruit. Peace. Happiness.
I didn't like it. Yeah.
Love. Long suffering.
Yes, yeah.
All of that stuff.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. And you know what? That fruit is sweet.
Yeah.
When it comes through some strokes.
Yeah.
When it comes through some tough times.
Yeah.
When it comes through some hard times.
Yeah.
Huh? When it took a little something to get that fruit out of there.
Yeah.
That's some sweet fruit.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And the master comes along.
Yeah.
And he picks that fruit off.
Yeah.
He says, keep on going.
Yeah.
This fruit is good.
Yeah.
I want to produce fruit that the master is pleased with. Has a master pick some of your fruit off.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Because one, he purges you.
Yeah.
Understand, Lord bragged on Job.
Yes.
Bragged on Job.
Yes.
Have you considered my servant Job?
Yes.
He can handle it.
Yes.
He can. Hallelujah. What we want to do is we want to make sure that we are abiding in the vine.
Yes.
We want to make sure that we're doing all that we can to make our calling and our election sure. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. You are my friends. You are my friends. If you do what I've commanded you, stay in the word of God. Stay in the will of God. Keep trusting Him. Keep believing Him. Abide in the vine. Stay there. Hallelujah. We are in a no-lose situation. Trouble coming. But it can't win. Problems coming. But problems can't win.
That's right.
Struggles coming.
My God.
Struggle can't win.
My God.
None of these things can overcome us. Because greater is He that is in you.
Thank you, Jesus.
See, all of those things come from the world. But greater is He.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. That's in you. That's in you. Than the one that's in the world. Yeah, get nicked up sometime. That's all right. Get beat up sometime. That's all right.
Thank you for your word.
What we want to do is focus on what we can give. What can we do for the Lord? And while we're focusing on that, why don't we focus on what we can do for others?
That's right.
Instead of focusing on the God that can give far exceeding above.
Yes.
You know, that's a spirit. And you know what spirit that is? That's that foolish spirit. Because the Bible says there was 10 virgins. 5 were wise. 5 were foolish. And the foolish one said, give us what you got. And the wise said, why are you trying to get my stuff when you could get your own stuff? So stop trying to get stuff from somebody. Why don't you give something first?
At some time, yeah.
Give.
Oh my God.
Give and you'll be blessed. You know how you get, you know how to get a lot of friends, right? You know how you get a lot of friends? One of the things you don't do, the way you don't get friends is to get stuff from them. If you always ask him, I'm always asking Ronnie for something, that's not the way to do it. That's not the way to do it. But the way to do it is do like the Bible said. He that would have friends, show yourself friendly. You want to have a friend? Give some love. If you give some love, guess what? I'll bet you won't have no problem getting love. But the problem is that when people get locked down on it and they wanted love so bad, they don't even look at the fact that they're not giving any love. Be a friend first.
Right.
And you'll have plenty of friends.
Makes sense.
Look to give. Don't always look to give. Look to give. And you won't have to worry about the getting. Because the Lord will take care of all the getting. So the next time you're looking to get something, take your mind off of it. Pray. Ask the Lord for what you need. Lord, I need this, that, the other. You have a right. Pray and ask God. Then go ahead and abide in the vine. And do everything you can to give to the glory of God. And forget about it. because the Lord will answer your prayer. Pray with me.